Thank you for being here. Sorry for the slight delays. I'll just go straight into my talk. It will be a few words and things about calcifying tendonitis, what is the cause behind it, and what are the usual ways of treatment. So this is not a new entity. It has been first described in 1872. And Codman himself analyzed it quite a lot. There's a big book, 477 pages, about Codman, and it's the origins of the history of shoulder surgery. So it's a nice read if you have something to do in the summer. Epidemiology. This is a middle age disease from 40 to 60 years. It's more common in women. It's not more common in overhead workers in repetitive strain and users of the arm, which is a little bit strange, but it has higher prevalence in patients that have issues with thyroid or estrogen hormones, and that might explain the fact that it's more common in the female population. Both were identified that it's about 2.7% of the population that may be affected by this disease. Once you get it in one shoulder, there's a chance of 10 to 20%, and that's quite common with lots of stuff with shoulder, that you get it on the other side as well. And it can be asymptomatic. So sometimes this is just an incidental finding. Once I had a patient that was referred with a foreign body in the shoulder, and that was a big calcific deposit on the right side. The most common tendon is the supraspinatus. After that, you usually have a combination of deposits in the supraspinatus and the subscapularis, and just the scapularis is just one of the other tendons. It's extremely rare. The cause has not been identified yet. The final product is deposition of calcium hydroxyapatite crystals in the tendon. But why does this happen? What is the story behind it? There is no real clear answer yet, even though there has been a lot of research, as you will see. What definitely happens is some of the tenocytes turn to chondrocytes, and then these become ossified, calcified. And then that process is reversed by absorption of the calcific deposits. There are two main theories behind this. One is the degenerative theory, which says that this can happen in areas of the tendon that degenerate, and then the calcific deposit is placed there by the body as a reaction to the degeneration. The other one is the multifaceted disease. This is where a normal tendon starts to express different genes, and those genes make the tenocytes to chondrocytes, and that results in the apposition of calcific deposits. So we have two slightly different diseases. One is the dystrophic calcification. That's a calcification that happens in areas of tendon that are already diseased and has a little bit worse prognosis because you may need to deal with the diseased tendon. The most common scenario, though, is the calcific tendonitis, which is a pure metaplastic disease where the tendon starts to express different genes and then become calcified, and then that calcific deposit is absorbed. There are genetic studies. The most common model for calf tear studies is the rat model. And there are two crazy people, Soslovsky and Thomopoulos, who've investigated anything we can think of in the last 10, 15 years. And they have done a very good study on the rat supraspinatus tendon. They showed that as soon as you put that tendon into a lot of pressure, or if you overwork the tendon, it starts to express genes similar to chondrocytes. And then if you rest the tendon, within 2 weeks, this process stops, and the only thing that is left is slightly less collagen in the tendon. This has not been proven in the humans. It's very difficult to find humans in the phase of the disease that they have not expressed symptoms. So usually you find them in a phase that they have symptoms, and that is the absorption phase. And then Mafuli has done studies in those patients and has identified less BMP and more catafysin, more osteoclast-like proteins. And that is normal because it's in the absorption phase. You have less production of tissue, so less BMP, and more absorption of tissue, which is more osteoclastin. But in the actual production of the disease, there are no real studies in humans yet. So there are four phases. There are many many theories around it, but all of them, if you collect them, you end up with these four distinctive phases. There's a precalcific phase where the tendon starts to express chondrocyte genes and attracts the calcification. Then the calcification phase is when the tendon starts to get calcified. Those two stages are usually completely pain-free, and it's the 35% of the patients that have no symptoms, and you can find an x-ray with a big blob of calcific deposit. And then you have a stable phase. They can stay at that phase for a long period of time with some mild pain occasionally that can be mistreated or thought of as impingement, especially if you don't have an x-ray. The painful phase is a resorption phase. That's when the inflammatory process starts because the body identifies calcific deposit in an area that should be tendon and starts to attack that area with a complete array of inflammatory cells. And this is one of the most painful, if not the most painful, disease in the shoulder. It can be more painful than having a fracture, and it lasts for a period of time that is not very predictable. Clinically, they present at that last phase with severe debilitating pain that happens spontaneously. Usually they go to sleep, they wake up in the morning and they're extremely painful, they can't move their arm, they think something really horrible has happened, and you take an x-ray and you see the calcific deposit. They can have stiffness, and this could resemble frozen shoulder. They don't want to move the joint at all, and it's very difficult to examine those patients. Sometimes they report pain referred in other areas of the shoulder, and they can have contractions or a lot of trigger points around the middle of the scapula simply because of the constant contraction of the trapezius and the levatoscapular muscles. On the x-rays, it's not extremely difficult to see. You see big calcific deposits. You can use these two x-rays to convey a message where these calcific deposits are, and there has been a correlation with the prognosis depending on where they land. So if you find calcific deposits in that top left area under the acromion or under the acromion here in those zones, then you have slightly worse prognosis because the impingement is even higher. Here the calcific deposit is outside, so it has a little bit more space for movement. They go by zone, so this is zone 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and these are just quadrants. You don't really need to remember these, as if you just say it's under the acromion, it's practically the same thing. And there are a lot of classifications about it. I'll go to that in a minute. The interesting thing is that they look white on the x-ray, but they look black on MRI scans, completely black, on both T1 and T2 views. So if the patient only has an MRI scan, you cannot say 100% it's a calcific deposit because all you see is a big blob of black thing. It gives you a very good hint though, but you still need an x-ray. On the ultrasound, you usually get the calcific deposit and a hypoechoic shadow underneath. This is, in most of the cases, when they start to present, because the calcific deposit is still organized in one unit. As soon as it starts to absorb, then you lose this hyperechoic shadow because the calcification starts to dissolve. And this is important in the prognosis, and I'll go to that in a minute. The mainstay of the treatment, though, is conservative. This is a self-limiting disease. What needs to happen is during the period of the pain, the patient needs to be kept comfortable with painkillers. Rest, because even the rat model has shown that if you rest the tendon, in a short period of time, you start to have changes in the genes expressed by the tendocytes themselves. And physiotherapy at that stage is extremely important because it can help two things. One is to maintain the range of movement so that you don't have a frozen shoulder at the end of all of this calcific process. And the other is to control the rest of the joint, to reduce this muscle spasm, to reduce the trigger points that will start to develop if someone is contracted and like this for 6 weeks or for 2 months, this process takes to resolve. And gentle, low-level exercises and movement to reduce the subacromial stress helps because it allows to maintain movement without continuing to cause the same stress on the tenocytes and then give them the time to stop this process of expressing the wrong genes. There are some prognostic factors. Orgon did this big study in a lot of soldiers and patients, and he found that within 6 months, 2/3 to 3/4 of the patients, almost 70% will do very well with conservative measures and physiotherapy. There's only a 30% that may need further treatment. And these were patients that had an average of 4 years of symptoms before they started having physiotherapy and conservative measures. Good prognostic factors is Gardner type 3 deposits. That's why I used only one classification. Gardner is one of the many. There are about 20 different classifications for this disease. They all describe the same thing. There's a deposit that is thick. That's a type 1 usually. It's a well-defined, consolidated. Then this starts to dissolve, so it breaks up. Those are usually type 2s in almost all of those classifications. And then it almost completely dissolves and becomes pieces of calcific deposit or a small cyst. And that is usually type 3. So if you already have someone that the deposit has started to absorb, then you have a Gardner type 3. So this is a good prognostic factor. It's already in the very absorption phase. And they don't have an SADO, those patients, and that is what the lack of sonographic sound extinction means. Negative factors, if you have really big calcific deposits that fill all of the underside of the acromion, these have less chances of absorbing simply because of the mass of the calcium that needs to be reabsorbed and the void this will leave behind. There are modalities you can use to help the patients recover faster, and again, these fall within the physiotherapy department. Extracorporeal shockwave therapy has been proven to be extremely useful. It comes in two modes, high and low energy. It's the high energy that is successful, but it has three significant problems. One, it's very painful. Some patients cannot tolerate and require anesthesia. It can cause skin changes, and this needs to be consented before you do that, because if the patient develops something like that, can come back and ask questions. And it has a very low incidence, but this is a very bad complication. It can cause AVN. It has been reported as case reports. It's very few in the literature. It's the ones that go into the 1% category, but you need to consent someone if you're going to do that, and they develop the AVN afterwards. Ultrasound-guided needling, barbotage, using even steroid injections is another way of helping. It has been proven that if you use shockwave therapy and barbotage, directly needling the calcific deposit improves significantly the results. You can get up to 62% of the patients that need some kind of treatment to fully recover. Steroid injections themselves have not been proven to make any significant difference other than improve the pain for a short period of time. If everything fails, then you may need to have surgery. That is the last resort, and as I said, a lot of the patients, more than 90%, will recover without the need to even see a surgeon. If there's a pathway where they first see the physiotherapist, usually that happens where I work. I never see someone unless they require surgery and they come to the last stage to find me. If you operate on them, there are a few rules. One is you don't need to remove the deposit completely, or you don't even need to remove the deposit at all, depending on which study you read. But you don't have to fight, cut the tendon, and pursue the deposit. If you clean the area and you allow the tendon space to breathe, often they will recover, especially if that is in the last phase where the deposit has become very diffused and it's very difficult to pinpoint it in the shoulder. Full thickness tears, even though there's a mass of calcium inside the tendon, are extremely rare. They're less than 4%. So even if you open the calcification, you don't have to fix the tendon afterwards. If you leave it, it usually heals very well because of the inflammatory process. If it's a very big deposit, sometimes what you can do, Porcellini says you need to do this in every case, but I don't agree. But what you can do is bring the two ends of the tendon together with two stitches, and this reduces the space, the empty space in the tendon. You always do bursectomy to find the calcific deposit, and there's a big, massive debate among shoulder surgeons whether you need to decompress the joint or not. In my view, you should always decompress, not because of the decompression, but because when you decompress, when you do a subacromial decompression, you produce inside the joint an effect similar to injecting PRP. So the bone marrow releases metalloproteinases, and these help the tendon to heal faster and reduce the pain in the early stages. This does not have a long-lasting effect, though. So if you look the long term, it's similar if you decompress or don't decompress the tendon. These are just a few pictures. What you need to do is the bursectomy. So you see here with the saver, you clean all the bursa, because what you are looking for is these cherry-like lesions. All those cherry-like lesions on the tendon will point you to the calcific deposit that lies underneath. And then you use a needle, and you see here in the needle, you see the calcific deposits when you pull them out. And then you can either use your needle to open the tendon, or you can take a knife and slice through the center of the tendon. And then what you find underneath is the calcific deposits. And then you need to use a way to evacuate them. You can either push them out or you can scoop them out with a curette and clean all or as much as you can out of that calcific deposit. At the final stage, what I do is I take the saver again and I remove whatever is inside, and then it remains like a big vacuum cleaner. And I just suck inside the tendon without causing any damage, because there's no tool that will suck, remove tendon, or cut anything. And I, as I said, I always do a decompression, because you see all of these molecules that fall on the tendon, they usually, in my view, help with post-operative healing. And thank you very much. That's what I call home now. Thank you.